All right, welcome. Thank you for showing up. It's good to see you all.
Okay, so let's see if I can get this to work. There we go. All right.
Okay, so if you're bored today, spring of 2020, it's that when change happens, we often have to update our teaching methods. In the past, we might have had a few semesters to slowly change our teaching styles as a new technology came into popular use. But now, with the pace of change moving so quickly, we have to know which changes make sense for us to jump on and which ones we can move more slowly with. This presentation will focus on the integration of ChatGPT into my spring 2023 courses. If we can time travel for just a minute back to December of 2022, when ChatGPT suddenly moved into our conversations, can we remember how we felt? Were we mad, annoyed, frustrated, depressed? Were we excited, interested, curious, hopeful? Were we somewhere in the middle, maybe flip-flopping as the news just kept coming? So thinking back to my own first response, I was mad because I had a paper that came in December during finals week and I just knew it was written by AI. And I was mad that the student would try and pull one over on me. But we didn't have much in the way of going after students who were using the AI to cheat, and that left me feeling dejected, but then also determined. My second response was curiosity. So fast forward a few days to a Facebook post from a fellow English composition teacher who said something along the lines of, huh, wonder where we might be able to use this new technology in our classrooms. And ideas for revamping my classes for my spring 2020 started forming. So I know it's kind of hard to see. There's a lot of text here. I can share this out if anybody is interested after the presentation is over, but this is my syllabus statement. And it's very current, just like I am, because we had no idea what we were getting into in January. And I just wanted something that would help students at least know that we were going to try something. So I wanted to strike a tone that was hopeful and focused on learning rather than focused on punishment. Although there is a statement in there about what would happen if they did use it in an unauthorized manner, because I felt like we needed to have that in there. So back in January, it was still the Wild West. I had no idea what was coming. My main goal in integrating AI into my classroom at that point was to see what it was all about and to see if we could leverage this new technology. So again, if you're interested, I can share this out with you afterwards. Yes. Yes. I created that myself. We had nothing at this point. So this was before the semester even started in January. All right, so I made changes to my assignments and I wanna talk about what I did with my three classes this semester. All right, the first thing that I did was in English Composition 2, that's in a 1000 level course. And we had a paper called Arguing a Definition. I decided that with the rough draft, the students would get feedback from their peers, from me, and then they had to put their assignment into ChatGPT and get feedback from it. And then they had to do a reflection piece comparing the human answers to the AI answers. So how good was that critique for them? I gave them an example when we started talking about, actually, hold on. Yeah. So the definition. We also integrated the idea of how AI is changing our world into the definition. And I gave them the example of customer service. So it used to be that when you contacted customer service, you expected to talk to a human. And now I think most of us know that we're chatting with a bot. And that bot usually has a really human name. Like we went to Great Wolf Lodge last fall and there was a bot that was the concierge. And it would contact us regularly before the trip and then throughout our trip to make sure that we had what we needed. So customer service has really changed because of chatbots. So I asked them to think of something, some definition that was changing in some way because of AI. And then they did this with the critique. Their second paper was interpreting facts. And I again asked them to do the feedback through ChatGPT and the reflection. And what I found interestingly so far is that if they had the opportunity to get all of the peer feedback and my feedback, that they tended to not find as much useful from the ChatGPT. But if they missed peer review and didn't turn something in for me to critique, then they found it helpful. So it's kind of a good second level. All right. Then they had a research paper that they're doing right now, and we're going to see how this goes. So the rough draft was allowed to have up to 40% AI content, and that needs to be in red. So they're showing me. MLA and APA do have citation guidelines now that are out. So I just haven't had time for us to shift this semester. I figured I would shift that over the summer. And then the final draft can be up to 15% AI. Also transparency, it has to be colored red. So everything that I'm doing is asking for transparency from the students if they're using the AI. And what's been great so far this semester, I don't think I've had anybody cheating with the AI because we are using it. We are talking about it every single day in class. In fact, today we're gonna go in and talk about Slides GPT, which I just found out about yesterday, haven't used yet. We're gonna try it together in the classroom and see how it goes. Then I have a technical writing course. This one is fully online. So the other two are face-to-face, but this one is online. For the job project, they each got put into groups. So there are six groups, about six different topics on finding a job. And each one of the groups had to put together a report and a handout. And then what I did was I switched them into different topics for a secondary part. And I had them put the secondary topic that they switched into ChatGPT to compare the information that it gave to the handout that the humans had given. And then they had to reflect on it. And what was interesting about that one, because that is a 4,000 level course, is that students found the human element of having somebody put it together on a handout to be really valuable to them. These aren't topics that are really divisive. Just like, you know, what are some good interview questions? What should I wear to interview? That sort of thing. So there's a lot of decent information on the web about that you can find. So ChatGPT did a pretty good job here, but most of the students preferred the output from humans. They're also doing a research project right now. And again, I didn't give them percentage guidelines on how much they can use, but they do have to be transparent. I'm only allowing it in the drafting stages right now. So we're gonna see how that goes. And then again, they can't have the AI doing all of the writing for them. I think that's a really important point for us to make, that drafting and brainstorming is cool. All of the writing is not. And then my History of Scientific Rhetoric course has to be my favorite one because this is all tech writing majors. It's a really small class. I know them and I trust them. So that also goes into how I handled this. I gave them free rein with transparency. They can use any AI out there for any purposes that they want to, as long as they tell me about it. And it doesn't write their papers for them. So the conclusions from their class, it's a great brainstorming tool. It is horrible at longer or in-depth writing. Now they are all using ChatGPT with 3.5. 4 is out, but it's only out in the paid version, and 4.5 is supposed to be out by the end of the year, give or take. So we are seeing massive jumps with each new iteration. And right now the current idea is that within 2 years of January, so less than 2 years now, we won't be able to tell the difference between AI and human written language. One of these students contacted me this morning because she had an interview yesterday and she talked to them about how she could use AI in her job. And I will be talking with HR either today or Monday. So they were very excited about her. And I think that's part of what we need to be thinking about is how are we preparing our students for the workforce that they're going to go into where AI is a reality. So I am not on the policing side. I am not on the let's ban this thing. I am on the let's figure out where it works to use it. So they figured out it works really well for brainstorming. At the 1000 level, it works a little bit better for drafting because they're not trying to do anything that's really heavy at that point. So, you know, a 3 or 4 page paper, ChatGPT can handle that pretty well. A 10 page in-depth paper, it goes off on different tangents. And it doesn't do well following its own train of thought. All right, so some takeaways from that coursework. We have to learn what is and isn't working. So all of these assignments looked at the possibilities for AI use. And since everything was so new, all I could do was hope that I was future-proofing my course for the entirety of the semester. And I think I did a decent job of it. I did make some changes to the tech writing report to allow them more freedom with the AI. So I'm trying to dissuade students from cheating by integrating it into the classroom. and we talk about it constantly. And I show them where it works and where it doesn't work. And I show them the hallucinations, and we talk about the problems and the fake URLs that ChatGPT will make. And, you know, Bing is an angry person, but it comes up with slightly better sources. And Bard still hasn't figured itself out. And my family and I have anthropomorphic families, so they're now Chad, Fish, and Brad. And so they have their own personalities. But yeah, we have to think about how we're going to keep future-proofing ourselves. And I don't think that hiding from it is the way to go. So I'm not seeing cheating this semester. And I run a Facebook group that I'll give you all the information for here at the end as well. I see a lot of people who are seeing cheating, but they're not using the AI. They're not talking about it. They're not doing the literacy side of it. And that's really where I think we have to move forward, is the literacy side. Students need opportunities to critically engage with the AI outputs, because if they don't critically engage with them, they're going to think that what the output is giving them is good. And as I think all of us who have used it know, that's questionable. All right, so some general lessons. Keep a syllabus policy of some kind. If your university has one, then use what they're doing. If your university doesn't have one, put a syllabus statement in place that talks about where it's okay to use it. And then I also put it on every single one of my assignments, how it can be used in that assignment. So I'm very clear on what is acceptable and what is considered unauthorized use. So again, drafting with AI transparency. If students are going to draft with it, they need to tell you what they did, what sources they used, so which AI they used, and how much of the AI made it into that draft. Okay, ChatGPT has good and bad uses. It's really good at critique. It's really good at finding basic stuff. It still has trouble doing long-term discussions and bringing back good URLs. But again, I don't think that's going to be that way much longer. I'm definitely keeping the reflections and the critiques. I'm very big on teaching critical learning, critical rhetoric. Like, let's go and let's think about what's actually being said here, what word choices are happening, what audience is happening here. So we're going to continue that in all of my classes. And then this is a big one. We have to be okay with the unknown. And as instructors, that's not always a comfortable place for us to be. But I walked into the classroom and I said, I have no idea what's going on this semester, and we're going to play around. And we're going to see what we need to do to make this work. So I was honest with them from the get-go that I had no idea what I was doing either. And I think that that's an important thing. Like, we can go in and they're over. So back in February, there were over 1,200 different AI programs, with new ones coming out every week. We can't keep up. 1,200. That was back in February, there were over 1,200 that were available in some way, shape, or form. So we can't keep up. We know they're watching TikTok. We know they're watching YouTube. We know they're on Reddit. They are figuring out all the ways for us. We can't build a wall high enough to keep them from getting over it. So we have to embrace it. And we have to allow them to teach us, which is actually really cool, because then it empowers them to feel like they're bringing something to us. And they're like, hey, look, I taught my teacher how to use this thing today. And sometimes we find out that those things do work, and sometimes they don't. Okay. All right. So I also have some DEI lessons, because I think it's really important for us to talk about the diversity, equity, and inclusion that does and does not happen within AI. And these are very basic. So we're going to have varying levels of AI literacy as these students start coming into us in the summer and in the fall. We've had K-12 banning it, which means that students who don't have devices outside of school-approved devices may not have learned how to use the AI in the same way that their colleagues who did have devices outside of the school system learned how to use it. And if they're learning from TikTok and YouTube and Reddit, they are learning all of the bad things. They're learning how to get one over on their teachers, because ChatGPT can write a level 5 high school essay for almost every content area. Yeah, it could do that even at the 3.5 level, but once it moved to 4, like everything except the English language went up. So again, we have to be really careful, like comfortable with that unknowing space and that learner space to give students a chance also to make mistakes. Because if they've only learned how to cheat, and we're going to take them through the AI literacy, and we're going to take them through critical thinking, and we're going to take them through how to use it well, just like with any kind of citation stuff, they make mistakes. So we have to give them the space to learn and to fix it. And that's also going to depend on our university policy and how that impacts unauthorized use, sort of thing. We need to move away from gatekeeping and policing student work. It's exhausting, and it's not our role. Our role is to teach our students whatever content area they need to know. And then in my case, critical thinking and how to be good humans. So that's what I'm focused on. And so, yeah, we're talking about this all the time so that I don't have to sit there and worry. You know, Turnitin allows you, actually, I can't say allows, forces you now to run everybody's stuff through the AI detector. But if you've been paying any attention to the stories that are coming out about that, we know that AI detectors are iffy at best. And at UCO, we do not allow that as the only method to show that a student has used AI in an unauthorized manner, because they're just not good necessarily. So the AI detectors, part of the problem with them is that students who are taught how to write in a patterned way, think non-native speakers, students who have to come in through zero level courses, that sort of thing, students who use non-standard dialects of American English, vernaculars, are more likely to be caught, even if they didn't do it. So we think about that. And we know this from cheating studies that, you know, anytime somebody's going through and checking a student, there are certain kinds of students. So we also have to set our own biases aside. Who are we checking if we do choose to check? Why are we checking them? What led us down that path? So I very much disagree with AI detectors pretty much at all, but that's because I am going back through and doing all of the literacy steps. I'm also not going to sit here and pretend like it's easy or fast. I had 3 weeks to throw together a whole semester. Not everybody has that grace. Not everybody has that bandwidth. So if you're trying to figure out how to do it maybe one at a time, you want to design ways to teach that AI literacy in some way. So if that means you've never used any of these AI options, go out and start playing with one just over the summer. Just get a feel for it. See what it can and can't do. Come up with some examples to use for your students. And then walk them through what does and doesn't work. So you're teaching them the basics. We want to help students see AI as tools rather than replacements for their work. So as you're thinking about how to scaffold assignments, and if you haven't been scaffolding assignments, you're probably going to want to start doing that, because it's really easy for students to get stressed out, not do any work until the night before, and then turn to something like this out of fear. So if you're scaffolding assignments, it's easier to keep students from going the AI route because you're helping them move through the assignment. And then we have to update our assignments to focus on our learning outcomes. If writing doesn't matter in the outcome, then why are we doing it? So for example, in tech writing, one of the projects that I absolutely love is an R&D project from start to finish. The students are in groups, they come up with a game concept, they have to build the game itself. They have to write all of the instructions for it, materials for it, and then they have to market it to try and sell it. So the game becomes the thing. And yeah, they can go out to AI and they can get concepts for the game, but they're still gonna have to put it together. Questions that they want to ask if it's a trivia game. And yeah, again, AI can write the questions for them, that's fine. And in fact, it might even help make the usability testing go a little bit better, because sometimes those usability tests get not so great, which is fine. But, you know, where can the AI help? And if the AI can help, let them use it. And if they don't have to write, why have them write? Okay, so then here's the QR code that hopefully, if you all want to click on that, you can, and it'll show you these other resources. For a person with generative dictionaries, there are 9 resources. Those are a couple of different sources that you can use to do it. There's also one here, Artificial Intelligence Projects, Lessons and Activities. It has a number of different activities. Some of these are based at the high school level. Some of them, I think, can be pretty easily adapted for the college level. And then I'll just talk to you about the other ones. I'll leave the QR code there for a minute. I also have a link to the book that I helped to write. So I wrote 2.33 chapters. The 2 chapters that I wrote were about policies for universities and assignment ideas. And then the one that I co-wrote was on DEI concerns. And there's much more on the DEI concerns in that one. And then I also have the link on there for the Facebook page that I read that is called Higher Ed Discussions of AI Writing. We have almost 2,600 people in there just since January or maybe December. It is meant as a positive learning community. So it is not a place to come gripe about the AI. It is a place to come and talk to each other, share assignments, share what's happening, concerns in a non-gripey way. So it's like, hey, I'm seeing this new thing that's not working, or I'm seeing students doing this, which isn't what I want them to do. How do we make that different? So that's been, from what I am hearing from people around the world, that piece has been pretty helpful. So I'm very excited about how that is going. All right, so now we have a little bit of, no, we don't. We don't have any time for questions. I'm so sorry. I know, I was really hoping we would. But if you do have questions for me, by all means, please email me. It's ldumin at UCO.edu. I could not remember where I worked for a second. what LDUM is UCO.edu. So by all means, please feel free to email me.